Alternative Investment Solutions, שבעצם מחפשת פתרונות השקעה אלטרנטיביים בכל העולם, כדי להביא אותו לאנשי המקצוע, כדי שאנשי המקצוע יהיה להם מגוון של פתרונות השקעה ללקוחות שלהם. אחד הפתרונות האלה זה השקעה בנדל"ן בלונדון תחת מטריה של חברה אחרת שנקראת סטלאר, כן, שידברו עליה. אחד הדברים הכי מעניינים שאני ודני עושים עכשיו במסגרת הזאת זה לקחת קבוצה של 15 אנשי מקצוע לסיור בין בתי השקעות בלונדון, כולל מפגש, יש גם הודעה על הנושא הזה בעיתון, מפגש עם הבורסה בלונדון, כניסה לתוך הבורסה, הרצאה של המנהלים של הבורסה בלונדון, מפגש עם בנק אוף אינגלנד וביקור במגדל הזה שאתם רואים, המגדל הזה שבנתה אותו סטלאר, זו אותה חברה שנשמע עליה כרגע, אוקיי? אז כל הפרטים האלה, אני אדבר עליהם גם בהמשך, ועם מי שלא יהיה פה, אז נוכל לדבר איתו על זה גם בטלפון. אני רוצה להגיד, תודה רבה. הוא לא רוצה היום? היום?
He's afraid.
אוקיי. דניאל. אני רוצה להגיד הלו טו דניאל.
Give him the stage.
Thank you.
Okay, so firstly, thanks for coming. Unfortunately, this presentation is going to be in English. My English is quite bad, but my Hebrew is even worse, so please bear with me. So I just want to take the opportunity to thank Goody and Funder, and also Dan Dobry for doing a fantastic job and helping us for the last few years. We've known Dan for now 3 years, and he's doing a fantastic job in terms of bringing alternatives to the market and you know, changing the way investors and also advisors think about investing. Okay, so the agenda for today, so I think I've got about half an hour, so I'm going to cover off, firstly, just a brief introduction of Mansell and who we are. I'm going to give you a little bit of a macro overview in terms of the UK domestic property market. I'm going to talk about our solution, which is working with Stellar, who we consider as being one of the best developers in the UK. I'll go through a little bit in terms of our investment process and our strategy. And I'll give you some examples in terms of our current projects and talk about the performance that we've achieved over the last 3.5 years. So to properly introduce myself, I'm Daniel McGonigal and I'm a partner in the business. I actually head up our strategic partners. So I work with basically family offices, asset managers, financial planners and insurance companies throughout the world. We have Leon, who hopefully you've read about in the magazine. Leon's our founder, and Leon's the head of investments, but he's a bit shy, so he's asked me to speak today. I won't labour on this slide too much, but I think a few points, and maybe I'll look at this from my perspective. So I joined Mansard 2.5 years ago, and I actually entered into financial services back in 2001. And I worked as a wealth manager dealing directly with clients. So you know, in the early part of my career, I was based in Hong Kong for 7 years. I was mainly doing things like sort of pension planning, life insurance, regular savings, that kind of thing. I then moved to Switzerland. I was in Switzerland for 2 years. And then I set up a business back in 2010, which I later sold before joining Mansard. In Portugal, and I was dealing primarily with retired British expatriates that were working on, you know, inheritance tax planning and pension planning and, you know, more sort of high net worth and ultra high net worth and building out portfolios. Now, one of the things then that led me to Mansard was the way that Leon and the rest of the team, firstly, there's a lot of synergy that we dressed the same. So we found out this morning that we both got the same clothes on, but the taxi was already there. But really that you know, Mansard is being very innovative in terms of what it's looking to bring to market. So you know, we've seen a lot of sort of the large institutions and banks now, because of regulation and what's happened during the financial crisis, just simply stuck in a box. So they have a mandate, they can't move outside of that mandate, and therefore they're all about protecting themselves and about regulation and making sure they're not getting sued, rather than looking at investment strategy, outcome, performance. So we are looking at delivering new ideas, alternatives that are outside of the normal spectrum to help investors deliver their outcome in terms of their journey. We've got a very experienced team. So Mansard was set up in 2010. Two parts of our business. We have a UK regulated part of the business, and we also have a Maltese regulated business. It's the Malta business that we tend to work in terms of internationally with our clients. But back in 2015, we actually sold our UK business to what was then a £40 billion platform. And Leon sat on the board and the investment committee and rolled out their investment strategy in the UK. So again, a lot of pedigree and experience in terms of the team. And we're global in our presence in terms of our investor base, but also in terms of our strategy. We have clients in Latin America. I was in Panama last year. We have clients all the way to Tokyo, the Middle East, the Far East, everywhere. So, talking about the sort of UK real estate market, and I've picked three areas, and I think three areas that we feel fundamentally are important to our strategy and our fund. One, we're currently in a housing crisis in the UK. Two, there's an issue with affordable housing. And three, the dynamics in terms of who is buying these buildings once they've been built is dramatically changing. So the development of the private rented sector in the UK. There's a statement from Theresa May, and the main thing that came out of her Restoring the Dream of Home Ownership speech, which was back in February, was that she feels that house builders need to be doing their duty and simply build houses. We're not building enough houses. So looking at the supply and demand, well, the population, as with most obviously sort of Western nations, is growing dramatically. We're now sitting at 65 million. We're looking to increase to 77 million over the last 25 years. London has grown by 2 million. It currently sits at around 8 million, and it's forecasted to be 11 million over the next 30 years. And that's led us to, in the UK, need 300,000 new homes to come onto the market every year, and over the last 10 years, only 165,000 on average is being delivered. If you look at London, we need 50,000 new homes for the current population demands. However, we're delivering sub 20,000 a year. Added to that problem is that last year, which is a little bit above the norm, but last year, perhaps because of the weakened pound, because of the run-up of the vote in terms of Brexit, we saw 62% of new builds actually being sold to overseas investors. But those are overseas investors that are not necessarily, therefore, coming onto the domestic market, but instead, they're buying these properties for holiday homes. We've got Malaysian, Chinese, Japanese, Russian, of course, buying properties, and some of them are buying properties simply for children that have not yet even been born yet, for when they might want to go to school or university in the future. So the problem isn't getting resolved. We see in terms of our approach, we're helping to meet the core demand. We're not in the ultra prime or the sort of the Chelsea's Westminster end of the market. We're in the mass market, and we address affordable housing, as I come on to next. So affordable housing, but what is affordable housing in the UK? Well, the average price across the UK is around 240,000, whereas in London that sits at around 480,000, which the big issue is 14 and a half times current annual average earnings. Okay, and obviously we know that banks will typically only lend up to 5 times earnings. So, unless you're fortunate enough to, and again, part of the Theresa May's speech was those that have wealthy parents that are able to provide that deposit or hand down some wealth are in a good position.
But those, yeah.
But those that don't, it is not. So what did you say?
It reminds us the Israel.
So, that's a good point. I was looking this morning, to be fair. Okay, they may not be exactly correct, so I used Google.
Not the numbers,
the numbers I looked at. So 280,000 is the average for Tel Aviv. The average salary is around 21,000, so pounds I'm talking, which is around 12 to 12 and a half times salaries. So it's very similar. There's a lot of similarities. So what is the government doing? Well, the government's got an affordable housing program. Okay, they're looking at putting 9 billion of public funding to try and address this problem. They've got a number of sort of tax incentives and schemes that they brought into the market. So you have a help to buy ISA. ISA just simply stands for International Savings Account, where it's your money's growing tax-free. And if you're a first-time buyer, then they will match your contributions up to around £6,000. Okay? There's low interest loans. So those that, especially in the sort of key workers field, so you know, if you're a policeman, if you're a fireman, you're working in a hospital, you're a teacher, those sort of things, you know, they're helping you in terms of giving you a low interest loan, and therefore you can borrow up to 95% from the bank. Sadiq Khan, the Mayor of London, is implementing new rules in terms of planning that he's fast-tracking those that are supporting the housing programme and putting them to the front of the queue. Okay? One of the big risks with a developer is the planning. How long does planning take? Can you get it approved? Can you not get approved? You bought a piece of land or a property to develop into such a certain vision, or can you deliver that vision? And the planning process, the longer that takes, the more that's eating into your costs. So, you know, we're being fast-tracked. The government is incentivizing developers that are looking at building sites that are anywhere between sort of 35 to 50% affordable housing, and that is in two ways. They're backing developers in terms of funding, but they're also looking at the end product and purchasing buildings or properties off of the developer once it's been completed. The biggest example that we have is Canada Water, and I'll come onto this later, but it's a joint venture with Notting Hill Housing Association, and Notting Hill Housing Association therefore has got government backing because we are delivering up to 50% affordable housing on an 8-acre site with 1,100 residential homes. So we've got public funding, we've also got backing in terms of they're looking at doing a forward purchase and taking 35 to 50% of our units off us in one hit through the housing association. And then the growing sector in the UK is the private rented sector. Okay, it's estimated by Knight Frank that the sector will be worth 70 billion by 2022, which means that we're looking at building around 15,000 new homes that are coming onto the rental market, so built purely to rent. Okay, so properties, you know, like this that are built very simply to then sell on to the government or asset managers or large institutions or sovereign wealth or ultra high net worths, and they're simply buying buildings like this that are going onto the rental market. One of the reasons why that's changing is that the UK is very entrepreneurial, and a lot of people, as an investment, go and buy a second home and then become an independent landlord. Well, you know, there's issues in terms of the quality of them being a landlord, but the government looking to try and stamp that out. So they've introduced tax on landlords that your mortgage is no longer deemed as a cost, and you can't write that down in terms of your profit. So if you're renting for £1,000. And your mortgage is £1,000, it still deems that you'll have £1,000 profit by 2020. So, you know, of course, that's deterring those small husband and wife teams that just want to build out and become sort of landlords. So institutional investors are coming in, they're buying properties, they're buying purpose-built buildings, they're government-led schemes, and the reason as well is the rental yield is still very attractive. So they're managing to generate anywhere between 3% to 8%. an average of sort of 5, depending if you're looking at blended between residential and commercial. And if you look at sort of back in 2009, where it sort of peaking around 8, you know, it still stayed pretty stable compared to the UK equity markets. And of course, the bond markets have dramatically come down and currently stand at around 1.5%, which I believe is similar to the 10-year in terms of Israeli government bonds. So I think the markets in terms of Israel and the UK are very much aligned. So, who is Seller? Does anyone know who Seller are? Did anyone read this gentleman's interview with Dan Dobry?
No, they haven't got the newspaper is that one this morning.
Okay.
They are not from the banks.
Oh, okay, fine. So, very simply, I think you explained, but the thing that the Seller Group are most world renowned for is the award-winning building, the Shard in London. And I'm going to just take you through a little journey of the before and after. So actually, just to touch on Seller. So Seller was actually set up 25 years ago. Irvine Seller, and you're going to have to help me again. Irvine Seller started off as a market trader, very entrepreneurial, and he was selling
Smutters.
Okay, but he quickly realised that he was renting his properties, and why should he be renting his properties? He should be buying the properties. So he started buying the properties that he had, and he went from selling Smutters in Camden Market to being in the 80s. He owned a business called Match, which at the time was the first business in the UK that combined women's and men's fashion in one house, and it was actually the largest retailer in the UK. So he then sold that. Thanks, Neil. I knew there was a reason why I bought you. There we go. So he built up his property portfolio, and then he sold that in the 80s and formed Seller Group as the business we now know. Unfortunately, Irvine Seller passed away last year, but his son was already sort of taking over the helm, and there was a change of guard, and it was James Seller, his son, who we went into business with 4 years ago. So they have very strong relationships with both local and central government. They back the government in terms of their affordable housing program, which is seen in Canada Water, and we've currently got 3 million square foot of London-based development projects, which include projects that we've invested into, which is Canada Water, Camden, London Bridge, and the City of London. To take you through the journey of the Shard, this was the building that was originally built in 1975. Irvine bought the building in 1998, and obviously had the vision that everything was on the City of London, so it was on the north side of the river, and he wanted to regenerate and rejuvenate the area of London Bridge. So in 2000, he then met the famous architect Renzo Piano, and with all good things, the Shard was born by a sketch on the back of a menu. He then got planning permission originally in 2002, but then there was an inquiry in terms of skyscrapers in general in London, you know, because of 9/11 and things like this. And then eventually, 18 months later, you know, planning was consented and approved, and then this building was demolished, which typically the whole building would have been blown up, but because it's... This is a hospital, guys, in St. Thomas's. It was actually taken apart in pieces. So it was the tallest building ever to be demolished in the UK. And then this was putting its place. So I think the thing that is important is the building was bought in 1998. Of course, we then had the dot-com crash. The building was delivered in 2012, and built, so bought planning permission through one financial crisis, and then built and delivered through the next financial crisis, which I think is just a testament to the pedigree of the developer and really the, you know, the vision that they have, but also the discipline they have of building through that time. So of course we went from a 100-meter building to a 309-meter building, and took it to 95 stories, and now this is sort of recognised as being obviously one of the best buildings in the city, known throughout the world. It's actually estimated that it's worth around $2 billion. To put that in perspective, it's also estimated that Buckingham Palace is worth around $1.5 billion. So currently the most expensive building in the UK. I'll touch on just a couple of things on their view. One of the things that I think is important is that thinking healthy, so building areas that is creating sort of pedestrianised streets, you know, shopping centres, cycling areas, inclusivity. So we're not building for the ultra wealthy and the ultra rich. We're trying to integrate communities and looking at both sides of the spectrum. So, any questions, by the way? So I'm going to come on just on to a little bit about sort of lending and how we invest Mansard into Cella and into their investment projects. So firstly, we're looking to deliver between 8 to 12% back to the investors, net of fees. And we're doing that by generating a yield in two main areas. So firstly, we're investing on a debt basis. So we're looking at secured lending on a first or second lien basis. So we're lending to the developer who's acquiring the underlying asset, being the property, and we're securing our capital against that asset. And we're lending on a sort of typical sort of 2 to 5 year basis. And the yield we're generating per project tends to be anywhere from 8% to 14%, which is therefore where we are blended across the project, able to deliver the investors anywhere between 8 to 12% as a yield. So most of the yield currently and within the fund is generated on this side. It's the mezzanine lending side. But we will also, you know, benefit from preferred equity. So in some, not all projects, we will also take an equity stake in the project, and therefore once the projects come to fruition, i.e. they're built and sold, we're benefiting from the upside in terms of the profit share within the structure. So very simply, the fund is in essence a means of replacing the banks. Come on to slide here, and then I'll go back. Up until 2008, banks were typically, you know, anywhere, well, on sort of fully let projects, so projects that have been built with then a tenant signing a long lease, anywhere up to 90%, but typical, they were lending up to around sort of 70%, and therefore the developer was looking to find between 10 to 30% on equity. That's dramatically changing. And one of the reasons why that's changing is, you know, there's implementation of lots of new regulation in terms of banking. So, you know, more reporting, you know, common reporting standard, MiFID II, monetary policy, government intervention, capital adequacy, and so on and so forth. So the appetite for lending on development is dramatically changing. And now we're seeing two types of examples, and I can talk through this in terms of the two projects I'm going to give you an example of later as well. So firstly, we have a more simplified structure, so perhaps this is a smaller building that you still have some bank funding, because bank funding is cheap, because interest rates alone are low, but that tends to be up to around 50%. So the equity is coming from the developer, but also coming from other investors, high net worth, sovereign wealth, institutional investors, and we come in at the mezzanine lending space, so lending a sort of 3 to 5 years at a rate of 8 to 14%. And that is typically a smaller project, whereas a larger project, a little bit more complex, whereas we might come in and take some preferred equity, we will continue to do the lending, but there may be some government funding, other institutional investors, and there's still some bank lending as well. Here's just looking at the appetite from banks. You can see it peaked at around 45 billion, whereas today the lending on sort of commercial is around 25, and residential has gone from 35 to around 15, and that's just simply going further down. Well, why? Well, other than just regulation, very simply, the banks post financial crisis, their capital has completely been diminished. So, we're gone. Take Lloyds and Barclays as an example. Gone from 120 billion down to 55, Barclays from 91 to 45. So we're having 50% of their balance sheets has been wiped out. Their ability to lend isn't like it once was. Compared to Microsoft, and they've almost trebled and doubled in the same period. And they're not part of the FANG stock either. So the Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google. Although they've taken a little bit of beating this week because of what they've been doing on some of the elections. I'll go through the process, Liam. Do you want to touch on maybe this slide?
Yeah, so there's really it's a revolving process. If we look at acquisition of a property, one area is seller. As a business, and because they've developed the Shard and a number of other developments on the go, get access to a lot of deals that don't hit the marketplace. And we can talk about one of those deals a little bit later on. But seller look to formulate an investment pack and outline the reasons why that they're looking to invest. Then we bring in what is an external committee. But yet that is an external committee that is on Mansard's payroll. And the pedigree of that external committee was one person, a gentleman named Tony True, brought the financing to the Shard. Another gentleman was the ex-CEO of Knight Frank, which is Asia, which is a very large valuation house. We look to then look at what seller have proposed and do independent due diligence. And then the third stage is it sits with the board to make sure it's within the credit framework of the offering document. And it's sort of that three-step process in terms of an acquisition that occurs. And then on a monthly basis, we all get together and run through the project on a quarterly basis as a detailed valuation. And on a yearly basis, we have what is known as a red book valuation, where we bring out independent valuers to value the underlying asset and make sure that the credit worthiness of the mezzanine is strong in the project as well. So this goes on a revolving basis. What we do find is bringing in the independents allows for the best outcome in terms of performance, but also risk monitoring as well. And we've been doing that on a number of years, and this type of process I've been instituting over a last 10-year period within Mansard with all the structures that we do run.
Yeah, I think the important thing on that is that we made a decision by getting into property lending, real estate, coming from a more traditional background in terms of, Leon managing, as I said, with AJ Bell, a 40 billion pension platform. That's more traditional bonds, stocks, alternatives, and a mixture of passive and ETFs and so on and so forth. Getting into the real estate market, well, we wanted to work with what we consider the best in the market, and we wanted to look at a process where we're investing into large-scale, purpose-bought development projects that a lot of due diligence is being done, that we're co-investing with the seller family and the seller group themselves alongside other institutional investors. So
As an example, one of the portfolios that we bought 2 years ago was actually bought in conjunction with Oaktree, and Oaktree is a $100 billion private equity firm. So rather than just being a lender and lending to small development property companies that could be the husband and wife team, and just being a lender and lending to anybody and hoping that the default risk is low, you know, we're committed to working alongside sellers strategically, doing a lot of due diligence in-house with them, and also using our external advisors and the likes of Knight Frank and CBRE to verify what is the likely outcome of any project in terms of our capital that's at risk, but also any preferred equity that we have in terms of the upside on performance of the fund. And that's an ongoing process. So we firstly review and then we continue to monitor. Just talking about some of the risks, well, risk is the price. Well, you know, the price of a property, obviously, you know, the market can fall. Well, that then comes down to our acquisition price. So, as Leon just mentioned, a lot of the properties or portfolios that we're buying don't hit the market. So we're typically buying at around a 20% discount to current market value. So we have some room there to be able to cater for a fall in the market. Brexit, obviously that's something that lots of people are considering and talking about, but I think that's more impacting the commercial sector than the residential sector. The residential sector is all about that supply-demand imbalance and the affordable housing. Even if we shut the borders and locked everybody down today, we still have that housing crisis. And then development costs. Well, development costs actually peaked and spiked around 2014 and actually have been coming down and normalised since in the UK. But again, a lot of the projects that seller involved with, it's managing that risk. So it's looking at, you know, having an agreed price with a contractor, you know, over a fixed period of time in terms of what they're doing. So, you know, having a disciplined approach to what they're building and trying to cater for a lot of those costs. The other thing, I suppose, that we can't have an influence on is government policy. At the moment, they want to build houses and they want to address the affordability issue, and that's not something that's new. That's something that's been going on for the past 3 or 4 decades. And, you know, whether you're left or right, both have a campaign and a policy to address this issue. So we can't see that changing in the near distant future. So I'm going to come on to two examples of the properties that we've invested into. Go for it.
So Canada Water is a property that Dan talked about earlier, that's backed by Notting Hill Housing Trust, a local borough within London. Canada Water was actually bought off, or was bought from Investec Bank, and a previous developer was an Israeli developer, Yaakov Black, who actually didn't go about trying to get planning in the right way. So very much thought that we would drive head on, and the project that I want is a project, or Yaakov is a project he wants to deliver. The difference between that and what we were able to do is, one, we were able to buy it off Investec at a distressed price because he kept on butting his head against it, or hitting his head against the wall, because he just didn't know the local Southwark Council and how to get planning through the Southwark Council. Well, seller developed the Shard, which is the Southwark Council, and was able to get, you know, close to a 100-story high-rise. And by able to buy it in distress, we already had spoken to the council on what we wanted to achieve. So going into the trade, we already knew there was an initial value uplift because we had already had side discussions with government. So do you want to go on to the delivery?
Yeah, so to talk about the site in general, you can see that we have the key site development. In terms of the area, it's one stop from Canary Wharf. It's two stops from London Bridge, which is where the Shard is. And, you know, if you you've been to the Shard, then it's basically a walk across London Bridge to the City of London. So we see this as being a sort of a suburb, village, town within London, but also a residential zone for the Canary Wharf and the city. One of the things that you know inspires me about Cella is, and I've said this in a few meetings this week, is Cella are not a trend follower, they're a trend setter. Okay? So you know, if you're looking at some of the development that's going on in London, Vauxhall and Nine Elms is a massive development site, but anyone and everybody is going there. Whereas you look at Canada Water, it's an old industrial, forgotten sort of almost wasteland that's next to Canary Wharf and in between the city. So as soon as we bought our site, and the maintenance site, British Land, the largest landowner in the UK, came and bought the adjacent site around us for 35 acres, and that's including a brand new shopping mall, pedestrianised streets, and a brand new area within London. It's the same with the Shard. The Shard, you know, London Bridge was almost forgotten compared to the city. Those developers in the city almost are very upset with Cella because there is a rule in terms of height because of the city airport. Of how much you can build, but they're already at an advantage because London Bridge is actually slightly higher as a bank than the City of London, so it's very unlikely that the city is going to have a building as high or peak above the Shard. So London Bridge itself, I mean, I've travelled around the world. 15 years ago, if you walked around London Bridge, it wasn't a nice neighbourhood, it wasn't a nice place to be. So what they've done by building the Shard is they created a tourist attraction in itself. You've got the Borough Market that everybody flocks to these days as well. And all around the area, there's a lot of development going on. It's become the new cool, the new hip place to go. There's a lot of artists and developers and lots of little coffee bistros and places to hang out. So again, they're a trendsetter. They're not a trend follower. And another thing that's happening within that area is they're building away from Cella, they're building in Rotherhithe. There's a drawbridge being built, which is connecting Canada Water to the City of London, to Canary Wharf, which will be the largest drawbridge in the world. So that would be, you know, cycling and pedestrian. So there's a lot of activity going in and around the area. And to give you an idea in terms of price, well, on one end of the borough of Suffolk, so South Bank by the river, compared to then Canada Water, as I say, two stops on the tube, you know, the price around Suffolk is anywhere between, you know, typically 1,000 to 1,200 per square foot, whereas if you're looking at two stops away on the tube in the same borough, the average price is about 800 square foot. 2 minutes. Okay. I'll get that.
It's all right.
No, that's fine. Okay. So there's a lot of areas to develop. Moving on to last one, and then I'll quickly summarise. This is the smaller project. This is 20,000 square foot, converting, going from sort of commercial, ugly-looking building as it is. We're looking to infill the car park. That will become a parade of shops. This is two floors, which will then go to three floors, and then penthouse apartments on the top. We have planning permission already been granted to take it from 20,000 square foot to 70,000 square foot, and we've actually just submitted planning to take that site to 120,000 square foot.
And on another point, so Teddy Seguin's ownership of the Camden Market is around that area. This was a site that didn't hit the market. We bought that 1 week after Brexit, and we know that he has been an eager buyer of this site for the last couple of years, and so that's sort of the difference between, you know, having a well-known developer who's been in London for 25 years and other developers in the marketplace.
Coming on to our returns, well, we've been running for 3.5 years, annualised return just shy of 11%, so we've been delivering our number between 8 to 12 as to what we're targeting. And to summarise, the 3 points that we feel that we will be successful and how we pull this all together is, well, firstly, we're working with one of the best developers. They've got strong government links, so therefore we're able to get projects off the ground, secure planning and deliver it. We're investing on a debt and equity basis, so most of the yield is being driven by secured lending. And then we're selling the underlying assets to institutional and government investors within the private rented sectors that are buying buildings, you know, one at a time. So we're not just looking at to flip properties and put them on the market. But what we're really doing is, you know, seller have the State of Qatar, which is the JV on the Shard. They're currently building Paddington Cube, which is by one of the top five wealthy families in Singapore. So they have the sovereign wealth, they have the high-end investors, the ultra-high net worths. And what we have the ability to do is come in on the same dealing terms and co-invest your client's money, blended across a portfolio, and generate returns of 8 to 12% across some really prime sort of positions across the city. So that's me.
Thank you very much.
And Leon.